So here we'll have some examples of polyrhythmic structures which Paco introduced to flamenco. That's another thing that didn't exist before Paco, and the real whereabouts of that, and origins and marvelous explanation which we will get later. But now let's listen how this music goes from one style, consolea, to tangos, to buleria, which all existed in the same rhythmical conception space. It's 12 beats. 12, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Chao, tu madre está por qué.
have the part. Now, this is the reason why they could do the transition from soleá to tangos to bulería, is because they all exist in the very same measure by inserting one overlap to the other, or inside the other, because mathematically they are all there, fitting. So let's see again this part. Nearly 12 beats. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 1, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 1, 3, right? So, yeah. Now, of this falsetta, 12 beats. And now look how this changed to tangos. Now look. Inside this exists, right? Oh, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now bulería. 3, 4. Right after here. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. And then we are in bulería now. So, I think it's very interesting. Of course, if I put here inside, let's say, this rhythm in bulería, I can put the tangos inside. This is a polyrhythm, and this Paco did it. He implemented this to the music. For instance,
12, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
And here I can place 6, tangos 7, 8, inside that. 12, how?
3,
here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, best referrals I have for explanations for theory matters, which this is a highly scientific thing, what polyrhythm is, and I don't want to give you what, in my opinion, nowadays, there are many channels of music, etc., of young people, and know it's not so much so young, but in my opinion, those explanations or ways to explain are very shallow, are the version light of the version light of what is already light. And I consider myself a serious student of music, therefore, let me explain you what I mean because now we'll talk of the great Leonard Bernstein, and we will get this explanation of polyrhythm from its original context and from the history behind it. As I was saying, some people have, they don't know how to explain it, they don't really know the thing, they have not studied music properly, they don't know how to speak to begin with, which I may be also included in this category because I'm from Spain. But anyway, let's listen here what I mean with this difference between the real thing, which may be called the old school brackets, and the light versions. Here we have some about polyrhythm, which this guy is asking about groove and stuff, but really what he means is polyrhythmic stuff. Let's listen to this.
How do you build a groove? And why do you build grooves with uneven subdivision?
Interesting, groove. So I guess in the same way that I find it a little bit unsatisfying to have all the semitones the same size sometimes, to have all of the divisions, all of the subdivisions within one beat the same size can be a little bit limiting. And obviously quantizing has its place. Quantizing being when you play a bunch of random notes not quite in time and you hit the quantize button and they all go perfectly in time to the grid. And that is fine, in the same way that autotune can be okay, you know, for certain kinds of music. But for me, a lot of the most exciting grooves in the world have, you know, the divisions are not necessarily straight. So if you take samba, for example, that is not straight, man, you know. But and similarly, there's a kind of music from Morocco called Gnawa music, and they have a similar kind of grid, and they have one in three divisions, which goes and if you slow that down and incrementally work it out, then just for my own sort of pleasure of working at speed, I guess that's 4-3-2. In a sense, it's like 4-3-2, yeah. 4-2-3. And that's actually the groove that I aim for in my room. Because that's the funky groove, that's not quite straight. I think what it does to the groove is it adds this feel, it's like it adds an additional momentum, it like adds momentum on an alternative axis to the axis of harmony, you know, or moments in the song where the section changes. It's a new way of generating sensations. If every beat rolls like an egg, it just, for me, it makes you want to keep listening to it in a different kind of way.
It's one thing that's related
that, like, neo soul fad,
to polyrhythm.
Right?
Close to you.
Yeah, right close to you. Yeah, I was guilty of that. And yeah, what it is, it's like the second division. If there are two divisions, it's just nudged forward, and everyone freaked out. Like, oh, how can we theorize this? And yeah. I was part of those guys, so I theorized it in a number of ways. So you can split the beat into five, you know, and then have three and two. So. And if you split the beat to seven, so 4-3, you know, there's a whole host of ways you can divide a beat up. But really, like, if you look at the fundamental reason why that feels good, it's because things that are straight and organized and regular, it's not really the way life is. It's not the way the world works. That works a lot more. It's a bit more flexible, and I think that if you listen to somebody deliver an idea in a very, very regimented way, or if you listen to somebody sing or play in a very regimented way, part of that for me isn't necessarily as kind of vulnerable or open as if it has space in it where things are wonky. And being a sort of lover of information and emotion sort of in equal terms, I thought about why that is. And yeah, so grooves in three divisions or four divisions that are wonky just make me happy, I think. But yeah, there was definitely like a lot of excitement when, you know, D'Angelo released that album Voodoo and it had a bunch of wonky grooves on it. And I think that I've seen an interview with Questlove where he just says, oh, you know, it's like play drunk. Like that's all he thinks about, you know. Yeah. And yeah, there are definitely ways in which you can achieve wonks by theorizing, you know. So like there's that bit at the end of PYT where I do that 5 and 7 thing, right? So it's like, yeah. Dun 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 d whatever it is, because I wanted to try and do that where the beat stretches to accommodate these new divisions. You know, when you divide one beat into four or five or six or seven. I invented a new terminology, a new sort of way of writing out time signatures, where you know you'd normally have like 4/4, and I figured there was a number missing at the top, which is like the number of beats within each beat. So you know you can have 4/4, but you can have like 5/4/4, where it's like. And then 7, like 7/4/4. It's still in 4/4, you know. So that bit in Hideaway, for example, in the second verse, when the measure number is at 49 BPM, really slow, and then the beat is divided to 5. So, and then the shakers are doing threes. They're doing. And for me, that's like an extension of that rolling like an egg idea, I guess, because, you know, the threes resolve every now and then the mandolins are actually doing fours, thinking. So they resolve every now and then as well. But then you have the kick and the snare on, you know, 1, 2, and then a snare on 4. So, you know, anybody's ear can hear there's a pulse, but I wanted to hide these delights of, you know, different rhythmic things in there, and it was fun.
On the harmonizer, okay, you sometimes
so
do this more
of course to... everyone will talk according to his own capacity. There's nothing wrong, I have no problem with any of this. But this is the reason why I choose the great Leonard Bernstein in the Harvard lectures, Norton lectures, about music and about poetics of music and the relationship of music with literature, with aesthetics, its aesthetic content, the arts. Of painting and all what is related to arts and especially music, because he was a great teacher. And I want to show you, just for you to see the difference between this and a real deep explanation in context, in historical context, about polyrhythm. This is the reason why I choose the great Leonard Bernstein for this series, to cover some topics like the origin of the whole tone scale and all these things, historical in the historical context. Because Paco ended up using it, and there is a reason why. And then polyrhythms also comes from somewhere. So this other thing what Jacob Collier was saying is nothing new, but actually very ancient. In the conical system, Indo system of percussion, has thousands of years this being explored of what he said times 1 million in complexity, and that will be a kindergarten joke what is being done, what these guys do nowadays, right? We did. But anyway, let's proceed to listen a proper, deep and real explanation about polyrhythm by Leonard Bernstein. I will post at the description the link so that you can see, because this is very, very incredible thing. You should see all the class. Of course, this was the time when people can focus and listen for 3 hours, one lecture. Okay, here we go. What is polyrhythm?
Remember, we found these rhythmic asymmetries to be syntactic equivalents, so to speak, of phonological dissonance. You remember? And in the same way, we can find a further syntactic equivalent with polytonality itself. And this syntactic equivalent is called polyrhythm. Another shot in the arm for tonality, another life preserver. What are polyrhythms? Well, simply what they suggest. Just as polytonality means more than one tonality at a time, so polyrhythms mean two or more rhythms going at the same time. For instance, if I start a tango rhythm in the left hand and superimpose a waltz on it. We've got a simple polyrhythmic piece, right? Now let's jump from that idiocy to great music, back to the Sach. Here's that fantastic page of Sach, which is all by itself a whole essay on polyrhythm. The meter, as you can see, I hope, is 6/4, meaning 6 quarter notes to a bar. But there's not a bar on this page that has anything to do with a sextuple rhythm, or sextuple rhythm, depending on which dictionary you read. It belongs to every note of music on that page belongs to groupings of 2, 4, or 8 beats. It's all conceived duply in multiples of 2. But the number 6, you will say, rightly, is both duple and triple. 6 is, after all, 2 times 3, right? Where does the 3 come in? Well, you can imagine the enormous complexity of the mathematical mishigas and turmoil that results from all this. Let me try to explain it as easily as I can. There are 2 sets of rhythms embedded one within the other. Not 2 rhythms, but 2 sets of rhythms. Now let's call the first one set A. It contains only groupings of 4s and 8s superimposed on this basic meter of 6. Now the main melody, which isn't as much a melody as a motive, as I explained before, is this scary fanfare in the tubas announcing the arrival of the sage. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, sorry. As you can hear, this is a primitive repeated motto in a regular pattern of 4 beats, right? Superimposed, remember, over a meter of 6. Then, that tune is whatever you want to call it, is embellished by high shrieking trumpets, also following the 4 beat pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Over and over. And against all this, the horns in their highest register are screaming out a counter fanfare in 8 beats. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4. So far, so good, right? These elements are all rhythmical blood brothers, 4s and 8s, even though they ride over sextuple bars. But all that makes only one set. Now let's have a go at set B, which contains groupings also of 2s and 4s, but not superimposed over the meter of 6, but operating within it, within each separate bar of 6 beats. Are you still with me? Just cast an eye on the percussion section alone, where all this set B is happening. There's the timpani pounding away in a steady cannonade of 8th notes, making, needless to say, 12 of them per bar, right? Each bar has 6 beats. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the timpani's going 1. That's 12 notes. And these 12 notes are demarcated into 4 subgroups by a specially violent accent on the first note of each group, like this. 1. Now, you hear 4 bangs per bar. 1, 2, 3, 4. You hear them? That makes 4 subgroups of 3 eighth notes each. And mind you, those 4 subgroups are contained within a 6 beat bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4. You hear the 4 bangs? Did you hear me count 6? That's a polyrhythm all by itself. But to reinforce these inflammatory counter rhythms, this electrifying stuff that's going on, to reinforce it, there are the bass drum and tam-tam alternately whacking out the 4 accents, right? 1, 2, 1, 2, in 2s. 1, 2, 1, 2. And just to top it off, so that you're all but out of your skin with polyrhythmic ecstasy, there's a guiro, a kind of rasp such as you hear in Latin American dance bands, right? All those things, which further reinforces the 4 accents, but more than that, doubles them, so there are now 8 notes per bar. That's 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So what have we got now? We got a bar with 6 basic beats in it, right? 6 beats a bar. 1, 4, against 12, which is really 4, which is also 8. Now, you haven't got enough feet and hands to do all those, but that's all, that's only set B. Add to it all those superimposed 4s and 8s of set A, and man, you've got yourself some polyrhythms. Listen.
Okay.
age of music is 60 years old, but it's never been topped for sophisticated handling of primitive rhythms, not by the Kinks, and not by Buddy Rich, and not by Mahavishnu, and not even by the Pointer Sisters. It's just fantastic.
This is Igor Stravinsky, Le Secret des Primitives. So, Consolación de la Primavera, no? Rite of Springs. And that's the reason why you can see what is real. This music was written in 1920. So we are not doing anything new with our so-called polyrhythmic. So this is exactly what Paco did, incorporated into flamenco. And therefore this is very interesting. We will take some more topics from this great lectures in Harvard, and I will post all the links in the description. Thank you, and I see you next time. I'm going to go to the hospital.